tomorrow on Wednesday, 17th April, we have a public lecture in the India and the Wider World series from Susan Penny Backer from the University of North Carolina. Title of the talk is Fire by Night, Cloud by Day, Indian, South Africans and Trinitarians Remember Post-War Cold War Nights. On 18th April, Thursday at 3 p.m, we have another talk in the same series as today, Integrating Social Justice Lecture Series of Sharmila Rege from the University of Pune, Reading D.R. Ambedkar in the University, Reflections on Communities of Meaning and Anti-Caste Feminist Theory. On Monday, the 22nd of April, Dr. Deepak Kumar will deliver a lecture in the Science Society of Nature Series. Science, Religion and Society, Snippets from Colonialism. And Tuesday next week in the weekly seminar, we have a talk by Prof. Sunil Kumar of the University of Delhi on deep structures, the capitals of the Sultan and the riverine plain of Delhi. It's a privilege to welcome Dr. K. Satyanarayana, the English and Foreign Languages University of Hyderabad, a very distinguished scholar who probably does not need an introduction to the topic, which he has worked for quite a while as Associate Professor in the Department of Cultural Studies in the English and Foreign Languages University of Hyderabad. He was active in the 1990s in the student movement and the founder general secretary of the Forum for Caste Annihilation. He's widely known, of course, as editor of the magazine. I hope I'm pronouncing it right. Please excuse me if I don't. Kulanir Moolana. His research interests are in the field of Dalit studies. He's co-editor with Susi Faru of No Alphabet Inside 2007. And those here two seedlings are sprouting in 2013. Dr. Satyanarayana will be speaking on caste, identity, and Dalit movements in contemporary topics.
First, I would like to thank Professor Mahendra Rangarajan for inviting me. I'm not so distinguished as his mentioning. I live in a small part called South India, so rarely come to Delhi, so we are not that big. But thank you for all of you for coming and also sharing some time for me. And these are actually some sensitive kind of observations. So let me start with an anecdote. So there was a small journal which is equivalent to EPW in Telugu. It's on political economy. So they're bringing out a special issue on various social movements. I'll also write on Dalit movement in Andhra Pradesh, different trends and different perspectives and all. So I wrote and they published it. And after that, the editor one day called me and then was talking to me. He told me that your paper has a lot of poetry, here and there, some poems and some references to fiction. And I wanted to delete entire that. Then the paper would have been only 2 pages because it has a lot of these references. So then he said, if you are writing a serious academic social science paper, it should have hard facts and evidence. And don't use poetry. So this is what he told me. So I was thinking about it, why I use this poetry. So what is this social science, hard social science? And in fact, I thought about it actually, why particularly certain poems I used. So there was this historic incident of massacre, Dalit massacre in Andhra Pradesh, Karamchedu, in 1985. Where six Dalits were killed, and it was an important event in terms of making the entire debate on caste national and debate in parliament. So it was in some sense the beginning of Dalit movement and setting up organizations and so on, and also all new leadership. So all were part of this movement. And that was part of the second volume of Dalit writing. I was writing something, then there was a discussion between me and the other co-editor. So the point was about that there are many explanations why this incident happened. Explanations from the political economy point of view. That there was green revolution, the larger spectrum changes, shift from bonded labor to wage labor. So there was this everyday money coming to the people's hands. So they are not dependent on the landlord. So it resulted in this kind of a tension. And they were voting for the people they want to vote. So this resulted in the tension between the dominant caste people, or the landlord and the village. So this is one explanation. Then the argument was that it is already known explanation, in the sense that it's a broader explanation where there are certain changes are taking place, and because of that there was this conflict. But what is the nature of this conflict? Why caste is such an central issue in this particular incident? Except that they are wage laborers, and now they are from liberty, they have their own money and some education, so there is this happened. So the caste explanation is missing in this. So in fact, many of the civil liberties narratives also in terms of the violation of the rights of the poor people, the state has to protect and so on. So there is a problem. There is a problem in terms of why caste identities of both the Kammas and the Dalits are important. And this is where I think I actually quoted this poem, because it explains something else other than this explanation. So it's a famous poem by Ghazal. Ghazal is also known as ML singer, who also did not write about Dalits. They were very humiliating about Dalits as agriculture and laborers, as two people who knew Dalits. But he was not writing of them as Dalits. So it was only for songs that he wrote. So the song goes like this. Youngsters resembling heavyweight, well versed in martial arts as well as education, ask those who belittle and denigrate them to mind their own language. They wear sparkling white clothes, moving their hamlet like jasmine. We do not own property, but we have self-respect, they say. When we sip coffee sitting on a chair, rich lords seep with anger. We are not living off someone else's father. We are eating our own money. It is our right, they say. So this is what the other has to say, that why this incident happened, that they are wearing this very white dress, and they are drinking their own kitty or coffee. And the people in the village, they could not bear. So this is the explanation. So this explanation is an explanation which you don't find in the other, whatever. Because this is a very interesting explanation from my point of view, in the sense that it captures something very specific, some specific detail. And in fact, the entire the other discussion, if you look at the backbending reports by human rights commissions and social scientists and also other kinds of commissions, so the discussion is about Dalit mobility in the context of the larger changes, the rise of the new property classes, the Kammas, and the rise of the Telugu Party, India becoming the chief minister, so there is a regional bourgeoisie. And also we talk about the failure of state-led modernization projects itself is in crisis. So there are all these explanations. But in these explanations, what is missing is the we of these people and their own way of thinking about it. That the sparkling white clothes and sitting on a chair and having their own. The whole idea that they are invoking their own human status. That the idea that they are of a certain kind of human being. So that is something that is missing in this narrative. So in fact, my paper is also on that particular issue. So the public discussion and also the academic scholarship did recognize some of the changes in the Dalit life and in the structural caste system. So the subjective dimension of Dalit politics and the Dalit reconfiguration of caste did not receive the required attention. This should be due to two important reasons. One, the limitations of the social science knowledge paradigm, and two, the elite and upper caste dominated structure of the social science discipline. And in fact, this is a continuous kind of a reproduction of knowledge about caste. In fact, there is a small booklet by Surendra Jodh for introducing caste. So if you read that book, you see the entire dimension of the Dalit thinking in the 19th and making such a kind of observation is completely missing. In fact, you don't have any single reference to Dalit movement in the entire book. Can we suggest it not for any particular reason, but it is a kind of survey of the entire sociological studies on caste. We are entirely, the story of caste is the story of caste by the sociologists, for the sociologists. And there is no outside view. So this is really, this is the tragic part of this discussion. So my main argument is that the Dalit movements of the 1980s and 1990s have reconfigured caste and shaped a new concept. I developed this argument based on my research into the Dalit literary and cultural writings of this period. I would like to locate this transformation in the context of Dalit mobilizations in the 1980s and 1990s and also looking at some of the global Chinese discussions. In fact, Gopal Guru recently rightly described this whole exercise of thinking of caste in some sense as the Dalit intellectual battle for self-justice. So, in some sense, so all this language about talking about this experience is developed in social sciences and kind of humanities. You don't really have a language to talk about this particular kind of experience. That is the trouble. So some items may not be very comprehensive and so. So one is, what is the context of this kind of shaping of a new concept by the Dalits? The first is the context of the Jumla Dalit market association, which already referred to Karanjedu or the other examples in other states. A phenomena which is very new in post-independent India. So not that there was no caste feelings of Dalit, it was not that there was no untouchability earlier, but the form of these massacres are new in the sense that killing entire people as a group for individual acts of violation of caste codes or any other sitting in a cinema hall or drawing water from a well or something, the entire village gets burned or entire group of people gets killed. So this is a particularly post-independence phenomenon. It is not the earlier phenomenon. It is a particular, and where there is also actively involved in most of these work. So this is where, in the context of these atrocities, you have this very clear understanding of where the particular group of people, dominant group of people in the village, organize themselves as a caste group. In this case, for example, we take Karanjedu as Kama, and you have a Kama chief minister, you have a Kama party which has come to power, and then you describe yourself as Kama. In fact, before that, they were part of the United Communist Party. In fact, in Karanjedu, most of the seats are called either Stalin Street and Lenin Street. So that was the village where suddenly they discover themselves as the Kamas, and they try to invoke caste as a certain kind of an authority, caste as a certain kind of power, caste as a certain kind of violence. So this is one kind of a context where Venice also reacted by saying that what is the wrong that we did? We are eating our own kind of food. And also this is a context where, if you are thinking of the SCST atrocity act, in fact it was a product of Karanjedu Center and other people who drafted that legislation. First time, earlier the legislations were basically looking at untouchability and civil rights, so those are the earlier legislations. But after the after Karanjedu, you have the national category of atrocity literally meant atrocity in the context of the SCST atrocity. So you have one meaning of caste as authority, as power, as violence, which was not there earlier. It was only caste as social media in some sense. Caste is some religion. It was not kind of violence. It was not a national category by any sense. With the legislation, it becomes a national category. So as a response to this, you have on the other side the emergence of the Dalit movement. The Dalit movement emerges invoking exactly the caste identity of Dalit as untouchable, as well as rising issue of self-respect and dignity, human dignity. These are two kinds of issues. In fact, many times Dalit actually is referred to Karanjedu agitation as self-respect movement. So self-respect is very central to this. And in fact, I would see that this is a very kind of important movement. The reason why I am arguing that self-conception of caste is very important, because that you have this explanation that Dalits or untouchables have no personality. That was Ambedkar's argument, that they don't have a personality. That they are collective slaves. And their oppression or their subjugation is not because of some imposed ideology and imposed structure, which is also because of internalized subordination. That is, they have internalized subordination and they are collective slaves and they don't have personality. And in fact, so when one commentary happens, this is the debate that Bhargava was raised, saying that, that they have been talking about civil rights, which he is able to know, but where is the civilian? So there is no civilian, so that's about civil rights. So first of all, they have to be human beings. So that is one kind of a context. And then the other kind of context was the anti-federation agitation. And in fact, we many times go back to Mandal, but in fact, the anti-reservation agitation starts much earlier. The Gujarat example is well known. But in Andhra Pradesh also, by 86, when Nitya Ramarao came, the first thing that he did was also try to mobilize the backward classes by saying that we will use 40% reservation. So there was a massive anti-reservation agitation. So at that time, the anti-reservation activists demanded the civil rights organization that they should actually protect their right to take over demonstration, public protest. So the state is kind of suppressing us. They are not allowing us to take out our position, and we should support. Because why? This is why they should do that. So it is a kind of mass mobilization that they are doing. But later on, by 86, so the understanding was that some of these anti-reservation agitations, they are nothing but agitations to demonstrate caste power and arrogance. So what are they basically saying? So basically saying that these people, the backward class people, are the Dalits, need to be in their place. So why are they saying that they want to come and sit in the office? So if you look at their forms of protest, whether they are sitting chappals and so on. So it's very clear. So the civil rights movement took a little time to finally to say that this is a clear expression of upper caste arrogance and demonstration of power. These are nothing but atrocities and then. So there's more or less, so what is the difference between what is called the atrocities and arrogance and these kinds of phenomena? So we can't support. Despite the fact that you are doing anti-state allegations, we can't support. So in fact, so the entire anti-mental agitation could be seen in that sense, that there is such a kind of demonstration of caste power, excluding the organized on caste lines. And then the related development of the relation of Ambedkar, the entire anti-caste intellectual tradition. And this is very, very important because in that time, again, the discussion on caste, as caste is something undemocratic, anti-national, something that cannot be part of the nation, this is not available. And more importantly, that the Brahmins are at the center of this particular order is something that has not been discussed. In fact, the idea that the Brahmins are an enclosed class is something that is very important kind of an observation. Till that time, it was only thought of as a structure, a system and so on, with no subject, no agency. But Ambedkar very centrally has this argument. If it has one wealth activist told me that if you have a kind of a very nice dress and smiling, modern, not following anything, any religious and so on. So it's only after giving Ambedkar in the 90s you could see to that man, you could see to the person and his own caste behavior. Till that time you were just assuming that they are modern middle class citizens and so on. Then of course the discussion in the elections and the way that Dalits have used in the elections, mobilizations and so on. So there is another kind of changes in terms of caste. And then the other example is the field of sub-caste movements, which are seen as movements divided the Dalit movement. You have specific caste movements, especially in South India, where you take the Arundhatiyas in Tamil Nadu, or Marigas in Andhra Pradesh, or several other smaller groups, forming their own organizations and making claims, making arguments, which are quite significant but are totally ignored. I think largely the social scientists and even the Marxists and other kinds of activists completely ignored these developments. I'm not saying they are very radical kind of initiatives, but they are important initiatives. If you don't understand this phenomena, you really have to pay attention. You cannot ignore this phenomena because they are very important, and important precisely because they are coming from these people and in a very acceptable manner. Of course, the other religious the discussion about Durban and Bhopal, some of these conferences, where again, there is another attempt to think of caste as अस्तित्व नहीं, इंस्टीट्यूशनल अस्तित्व नहीं, कैस्ट एक्यूमुलेट पहले, तो इट इज दैट अनदर वे ऑफ थिंकिंग ऑफ कैस्ट. इट अगेन सोशियोलॉजिस्ट हैव रिएक्टेड वेरी वेरी काइंड ऑफ नेगेटिवली एंड ऑल्सो आई वुड से इन अ पैडांटिक मैनर. The thing is, look at the text that you wrote, that it doesn't work. So, but the point is that there is a certain kind of a concept that they're developing which you are not willing to engage. So, this I would say is the broader context of where you have certain kind of understanding kind of emerging in India. Then, and what to the next section where I would call it broadly the Brahminical theory of caste. And which I'm not mind used by another elementor. So if you have to talk about Dumont's book and the writing review, so he called he said that maybe Dumont was talking to Brahmin too much, so he produced this kind of thing. So the commonly held idea that caste is a remnant of pre-modern hierarchical purity pollution formation specific to Hindu religion is criticized and rejected. Caste, in this point of is a life force in modern Indian culture and politics. The revolutionary caste system transforms what is actually a contemporary form of power into an outmoded religious practice that disadvantages those subjected to social stigma and social exclusion. In other words, the caste issue is morphed into a problem of the social and economic marginalization of one section of society. And the caste problem is seen as a problem only for the lower caste who suffer from it. The social and political dominance of Brahmin and other upper caste, their role in perpetuating and extending caste relations to abolish, not only directed at the economy that produced this theory, but also at the efforts of the Indian state to address caste inequities that are based on such theory. In fact, the anthropological notion of caste as a religious hierarchy has informed state action. Thus, the Nehruvian consensus was to eliminate through planning, education, and administrative actions, anomalies like caste in order to make India modern and secular. The state designed developmental program to address disability, such as bonded labor, untouchability, manual scavenging, and atrocities, through rural development, poverty elevation, land reforms, the Anti-Untouchability Act, and so on. So in this scheme, reservations are considered compensation for past wrongs and not as remedy for current oppression and marginalization. So the scheduled caste and other oppressed caste groups are regarded as suffering from known injuries caused by residual pre-modern formation. Further, they are merely target groups for welfare programs extended by the state. So I would assume the dominant way of thinking about it. You have many other variations, but where mostly caste as a concept system, caste as a system of interdependence, dependence, and so on. But you really don't find an example of caste as a system of conflict. So you have, in fact, so this is a refers to only one article of one sociologist talking about caste as equality. They were saying that doesn't talk about caste in those terms, not even as an equality. So in terms of Indian constitution also talks about caste as disability. There were disabilities imposed on a certain set of people. So nothing more than that. So the important line of critique of caste is that of the norm of the secular citizen. This norm is a filler. And the assumed neutrality with which it occupies the public domain was shown up as marked by caste and as reaping the benefits of caste power and privilege. Since this figure is foundational for modern institutions, law, education, knowledge form, the art, public culture, it is also the principal modality through which these institutions practice caste. In some sense, the entire, for the first time after, for example, say, Karan Chedu, that you have a lot of discussion on Kamal, and I mean the Kamal and the community and so on. And not before that. Earlier, they were only either secular left people, they are Marxists, or they were landlords. So the incident happened also in many left groups to describe things as the landlords attacking the Dalits and so on. So the first time, the landlords becomes the upper caste figure. Then apart from the sociology discussion, so we also have two interesting kind of discussions. Earlier I said that there were attempts to kind of look at some changes in Dalit life. There was Karan to really notice this. So one notable kind of example is Rajiv Kothari's 1994 piece, which is the title itself is very interesting. The Rise of Dalits and the Renewed Debate on Caste. So that is match my captain about that. In fact, he kind of very aptly talks about it, that there is a certain shift in thinking of caste, and thinking of caste as identity, and then the arrival of that into the public domain, into the public sphere. So in fact, I want to quote him here. For long, consciousness of caste was the preserve of the Brahmanic upper caste. Today, something quite different is happening. The very sufferers from the system, including the caste system, are invoking caste identity and claims. And in fact, the most important quote is the next one. Again, I quote, ideologically, there took place a basic shift from hierarchy to plurality, from ordained status to negotiated positions of power, from ritual definitions of roles and positions to civic and political definitions of the state. So this is a kind of definition, this is an argument that we have been making from quite early. This is called now the politicization of caste, that because of modern election and enumeration and so on. So there is a certain kind of politicization of caste. But more interestingly, that he really identifies this movement as the movement of Dalit politics. And that is the kind of articulation of caste as an identity. And in fact, you have the other important commentator, D.L. Thayer, which is again based on an excellent certain kind of field work. And he comes to more or less similar kind of conclusion, and where he was arguing that there is a shift from the hierarchy to different plurality. And in some sense, he's saying that maybe one could describe this as a collective, certain kind of collective. These caste are functioning as collectives. So there is a functioning as horizontal groups. So the whole idea of caste as a hierarchical system may be something that is changing. And then you have Kevras is also kind of arguing that now you have there is this kind of Kevras and many others, that there is this distinction between the caste system and the caste now. So the caste system is more or less on its way, that you have different castes as groups. And you have these famous Dumont's idea of substantialization as groups, as blocks of each caste as a block, and so on and so forth. But one of the problems is interesting aspect is that there is a kind of a clear identification that there is a shift and there is a change. But also there is a problem in the sense that Indian discussions of the caste still remain the traditional institution. So this is only a story of modernization. So how in the context of modern domain it is changing. It is changing to make a new middle class, changing to make something else. So the paradigm of traditional modernity, though not openly involved in a major manner, but the paradigm still kind of still remains. And that is, I think, kind of one problem. But if you follow the line of the Dalit politics, if you follow the line of its identity line, and all those that actually Ranjit Varpotari hinted, then it actually you actually can deliver a different kind of a story than the prophet saying that there are certain changes and caste is changing and so on. And in fact, there are objections to this argument by saying that, and in fact, the discussion only takes place on two grounds. One is that no, there are no changes. And in fact, when we wrote this in our book, I think Srinivaslu reviewed in EPW, one of the major points is that hierarchy is important, and the whole idea of caste as endogamy, hereditary, that notion is very important, and you cannot argue that it is changing. And the structural principles of caste remain intact, so that's one kind of an argument. The other kind of an argument is it is changing. But in fact, I'm arguing that there is this subjective dimension of this Dalit politics, which is something that which is not taken up by either of these kinds of groups. So another important, I will discuss that for another few minutes. So another important theoretical development takes place at this time. The idea of caste as an object of structure, as in a caste system, or an empirical information such as census count, is displayed. Caste emerges as the subjectively affective identity of a social group. And in fact, you can go back to actually Mandal to notice this more clearly. The opponents of Bobby's reservation represented themselves as secular and modern citizens by invoking national interest, merit, efficiency, and so on. In this argument, those who publicly invoke caste by asking for casteless reservations are labeled as caste, and those who denied caste were considered casteless and therefore secular. Dalit pointed out that this understanding of caste was faulty and biased, and that it obscured the connection between caste and the privileged life of the secular Indian middle class. And casteism is not the entry of Dalits and OBCs into public institutions on the basis of caste. It is the existing caste-based privilege and power enjoyed by the upper caste in their location. And in fact, you have, this one is a study where you really show in education, employment, political arena, the absence of Dalits and OBCs, and you have the total science kind of a data also. But interesting here, to think of the secular citizens, I have two examples. One is that the B.M. Vinaya, a very kind of a well-known journalist in Delhi, wrote a small piece when Kantaram slapped the journalist. He wrote a small piece, it is titled, "In Search of the Dalit Journalist." So where I think one Dalit journalist called him and asked him, "Do you know any Dalit journalist? I wanted to ask you for a quote about this particular incident." And then this very interesting narrative about how various people respond, especially Indian middle class journalists respond to this this idea. But the point about that piece is that he found out that there was no single Dalit in entire Delhi in the existence of journalists. So he says that this is casteism, because in the end, one of the journalist friends called him, "You are such a secular democratic journalist, and you are the end of the world, and why are you looking for a Dalit journalist?" Then he said, "I used to think so, but after this discussion, when I did not find anybody, I don't think so." So there is a different kind of a meaning of this secular. And in fact, similarly, you have another example from Chandrapan, though written in small here and there. And he said that we were walking to a leftist friend in JNU, saying that if you do this for me, I will give you a party in my house where there are some Dalits invited. So he will be invited to a Dalit party. So this other friend was really offended, saying that, "What do you mean? And I work among Dalits and I do all this." So then this whole discussion about when you have your own informal dinners and meetings and so on, so how many Dalits are there and the guest list and so on. So do you have any connection with these people? So there is a certain kind of discussion which is not, become widely available and public. And then the Dalits are hitherto being a burden with imposed identities as untouchable, different classes, horizons, and the dual caste. So even the secular temple narratives in the mental discourse stigmatize caste identity, depicting as divisive and as a social evil. While the upper caste bring their culture and self-esteem into the secular modern arena, Dalit life world are suppressed and Dalit misery is too rapidly interpreted, indeed taken as known. In the process and in the mainstream representation, Dalit identities are undermined, their art, culture and history obliterated, devalued, stigmatized, their everyday life degraded, the actual forms of their misery obscured. Dalit contested the tendency to treat caste only as an instrument of oppression and recreated it as a new identity of self-assertion and pride. Thus, Dalits and other subordinates to caste invoke caste ties as signs of solidarity, fraternity, pride, self-respect, assertion and unity. They regard caste as a shared experience not only of oppression but also of the history, myth and culture of a social group. This caste identity, Dalit writers have argued, captures Dalit community life in urban as well as rural urban settings. It recovers and valorizes histories of specific caste leaders and reaffirms the range of Dalit cultural religious practices. In these arguments and narratives, caste acquires a new meaning as cultural capital of a community. Such political identity also forms the basis for determining access to resources and entitlement to rights in a modern democratic society. While for the upper caste enables social dominance, hegemonic power, subordinate caste reverse caste to reaffirm the solidarity of the community, retain a world and affirm self-position and confidence. So in fact, caste is now a computer formation that may be employed to erase prestige, arrogance, privilege, dignity and power of social groups in India. It is articulated as a political person aimed at changing the existing equations of caste power. And in fact, I have looked at three sites. One, the village situation, which I think I talked about it in the context of Karanchero and atrocity, and how caste becomes an important a national category, though the incident happened in the village. And then the other example is of the university. So, in the university where one of the the consequences of the Mandal debate was the discussion of the university and especially the big metropolitan universities as a model type of caste prejudice and discrimination. During the protest, any type of caste students have virtually brought universities to a close. This agitation and its humiliating campaign against reservations and by extension SCSTs who had hitherto enjoyed reservations made it necessary for Dalit students to form forums to articulate their concerns. Several new Dalit students forums and Ambedkar associations were set up at that time outside mainstream political party affiliated student forum. I think largely because I have something else in the end, so I want to skip this section. But broadly what I am saying is that the university has become an important site of discussion of caste in terms of, in fact, the usual example is the suicide. The suicides both in Hyderabad here, and there are small forums of students making arguments about the dropout rate, about the curriculum, about other forms of exclusion. And the other example is also that for the first time, the higher education and the social science disciplines also become visible nationally, especially for Dalits and other people. So it becomes visible at the national level. So one example is the sociology. The Indian sociology continues to think of caste in the ideological mode as the ugly face of tradition that was being modernized by the liberal democratic world. So another strand conceptualized caste as a consensual system following M.N. Srinivas's concept of consolidation and westernization. It prioritizes consensus in the caste order and reduces Dalits and the lower caste to the status of imitators of the upper caste. However, sociologists are unable or unwilling to engage with the persons raised by anti-caste thinkers or by the new social movement. Dalit life, their personal protest, and the persons raised in his protest found no place in sociological studies. In fact, Dalit assertion in the university pushed social sciences as well as humanities into a place. In fact, I am mentioning the example of Jyotsna, the recent example, where you don't find a mention of a Dalit anywhere except Gopal Guru and Borat, and nothing else, and no reference to any Dalit movement. So that is the case of the sociology. So the university was also the context for the emergence of significant Dalit women student organizations and so on. So I think the last and important part that I really wanted to talk about today is the field of subcats, the various Dalit cats organizing themselves and making certain kind of demands. So this is where I think you have a very interesting clue about how cats operate. The assertion of Dalit and also specific OBC subcats for rights and power brought out such contradictions in the field of cat policy. Only with the new movements of this time does it emerge that the native category, sexual caste, comprises a collection of castes that experience intra-caste antagonism and are internally divided. Further, that each of these castes has their own distinct history and culture. The sociological understanding of subcaste among the SCs takes a political form in movements such as those of the Arundhatiya in Tamil Nadu and the Madhidas in Andhra Pradesh, who use the term subcaste to critique and reject it. Engaging in this field set up as SCs and Dalits, these new caste movements demand equality within these fields. And in fact, some of these movements are quickly kind of described as a very degenerate form of that quality, and they really don't take notice. So I am still looking at one such example from Andhra Pradesh. So the late 1990s is marked by what have been termed splits and fragmentation of Dalit movements. Internal tensions and contradictions between Dalit caste, among other problems, divided the Dalit movement into specific caste movements and small forums. The Dalit literature of this period is marked by the awakening and assertion of individual untouchable jatis. The subcaste movements and the new religious cultural mobilization of jatis brought new persons to the fore. Persons of rise of structural hierarchy and social inequality among different scheduled castes, as also those of an oppressed caste identity that is rooted in culture and history and strengthened by its own myths and issues. I have discussed the Madhidas movement in Andhra Pradesh as an example of subcaste movements. And turn after that to the to pursue the caste identity and cultural religious tradition. So the Madhigas, some of you might be familiar with this story of the Madhigas. The Madhigas, some of the scheduled caste of Andhra Pradesh, formed the Madhiga Reservation Quarter Assembly in 1994 to fight for the subdivision of scheduled caste reservation as well as the welfare benefits available to the SC. And that is about 59 castes and 15 bucks of derivation, which is divided into four groups, agencies. So this movement, popularly known as Madhiga Dandara movement, is seen as a movement for equality between the oppressed SCs. The managers have put pressure on the state to pass a legislation subdividing SC reservations into ABCD groups on the basis of their relative inequality, social, educational and cultural, and the percentage of their population among the 59 listed SC castes in Andhra Pradesh. Of these two formerly ancestral communities, Mala and Marja, are the largest. Together, these two communities comprise 80% of the SC population of the state. So the problem of subdivision therefore has taken the form of a Mala-Marja conflict. The MRPS under the leadership of Krishna and Prabhakar, who changed their names to Krishna Marja and Prabhakar Marja, using the caste name as the suffix in the form of reception, conducted dhanas, rallies, mosque programs, public meetings, and other campaigns. A cross-section of the Marja community, principally government employees, women, girls, as well as Marja writers and artists, were among the first to join the movement. But it soon received support from other sectors too, so much so that the Marja Sandhara movement has been described as one of the biggest mosque agitations in the recent years. MRPS consolidated the Marja to the community and at the same time also sought and received support from various left and other democratic organizations as well as mainstream political parties. A solidarity committee of different people's organizations and individuals was formed with the well-known Rajajan Sadar as its convener. It extended kind of active support to the MRPS movement. The immediate issue that came up for debate during the course of this massive mobilization of Marja from 1995 and to 1999 is the complaint that a few among the scheduled castes had secured the disproportionate benefit from SC reservations to the detriment of others. In 1996, the Andhra Pradesh government appointed a one-man commission headed by Justice Ramachandra Rao to examine this issue. And then the story is that, that the commission found that there are disparities and recommended that these reservations should be divided into four groups. And the principle is that whoever is the left backward will start from A, and also as for the population, it will be divided into four groups. But that is not very important for my story. And so this is a kind of a long story of political plans in the corridors of law and administration. And we have to look at that in the community. This is making certain community clients looking at history and also certain kind of cultural kind of a movement. But it's actually a long story of political clients in the corridors of law and administration. The High Court of Andhra Pradesh shut down the government GO. The National Commission for SCs and SCs interpreted the GO as unconstitutional. And the state governor referred the ordinance to the President of India. Finally, the President of India approved the ordinance for the subdivision of SC reservation. With the enactment of the Scheduled Caste Rationalization of Reservation Act 2000, categorization of SC reservation was implemented between April 2000 and November 2004. However, when the Mala representatives appealed, the Supreme Court set aside the AP Act of 2000 on the grounds that according to the Constitution, Scheduled Caste is an indivisible category and any subdivision is therefore unconstitutional. So more or less that is where it stopped. So the political form and the achievement of the struggle put in place by the Marja movement are in many ways unprecedented. They work politically with arguments and information to bring together the Marjas and gather the support of others. At the same time, they worked on the government to marshal its support for the equal sharing of reservations. In the process, the omnibus category of scheduled caste was redefined, the constitution reinterpreted, the reservation policy reformulated. What is more, the Marjas' conception of their self and community and their agenda for democracy based on the unity of the oppressed caste, as opposed to caste annihilation, opened a new debate on caste politics. Here I have some poems and all that, but I have not read poetry, but I will come to some of the conclusions of this. But the immediate demand of the sub-caste movement is to subdivide and share reservations, another cultural sentiment. But these open up larger theories and questions. We will examine two of them. One, the division of Dalit agenda of caste annihilation, and two, the conception of new discourse of caste. So in the Dalit movements of the 1990s and 1980s, Dalit is proposed as a term for the untouchable caste as a whole. This is a politically significant effort to integrate the untouchable into a single community and mark their difference from caste Hindus. In addition, it held up the ideal of elimination of caste, Hindu-imposed identities such as Panchama, Chandala, Anjana, etc. As a result, Mala, Marja, Palaya, and so on were also viewed as syncretized. From the time of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Dalit movement had held up its identity and proposed a program of caste annihilation to create a democratic society. The assumption that the caste order is only that which is imposed by caste Hindu society obscures the well-entrenched caste disparities and discrimination among the Dalit caste. treating all undesirable characters as equal actually reproduces disparity. As Manjushri has showed, a reservation policy that did not recognize disparities among the SCs of Andhra Pradesh actually produced the disparity. Secondly, Manjushri proposed a revision of the Dalit Social Revolution by valorizing a Madhika identity, practice like attaching Madhika as a suffix to name and invoking Madhika history and culture. Caste generation, this indicate has to be rethought as a project where caste identities may remain as masters of the culture and history, but inequalities and indignities will be eliminated. In addition, these post-1990s movements add a new dimension that of cultural identity to the notion of caste. The word of undesirable, once stigmatized and banished from public accounts, reappears. This is made possible by shifting the discussion from elimination of caste to equality of caste, from equality of individuals to equality of caste. It was argued that it is the dignity of the Madhika caste that will ensure dignity to individual Madhika, his or her identity and culture. Interestingly, this patterning of a distinct caste identity is part of a struggle for fighting the indignities and inequalities of caste status. So the debates around Madhika literature and more recently these will help us understand appreciate the complexity of conceptualizing caste as identity. The deep issue, I will say from the 5 minutes, the deep issue will also help us grasp the politics of caste in sub-caste movement. Put is an important topic in Dalit literature. Dalit activists have also debated culture around disturbing and publishing beef in public. In Karnataka, they protested against a law which banned the sale and consumption of beef on Ambedkar Jayanti and threatened to cook and serve it in the public on this occasion. The much publicized beef festival in Osmania continues in engagement. There, Dalit, OBC and left student activists question the exclusion of Dalit food cultures from hostel menus, restaurants and other public places. The public beef eating was not just an exception of the right to food or a celebration of India's diverse food culture. As Samaya Gunamada argued, the suppression of, I quote, suppression of food cultures in a modern public space not only reinforces the exclusion and humiliation, but also causes injury to the agency and the identity of the marginal community. So this whole the cultural arguments indicate that Madhika has a distinct kind of meaning. They are not a question of culture. Therefore, it suggests that it is not enough to accord representation to marginalized culture. Such representation needs to be accompanied with respect of the other. In other words, recognition and respect of the identity of the Dalit caste is the message of the beef festival. The rise of Madhika literature, the struggle for eating beef, reformulates caste as a network of solidarity and cultural pride. The Madhika proposal for a unification based on the recognition of identity in order to fight the upper caste notions of caste as dominance, violence and inequality makes the debate on caste inequality theoretically complex. So I want to conclude by saying that what I am arguing is that this whole of the earlier theory of the caste is linked to Hindu system, endogamy, heredity, and there is a structural principle, and it is a kind of algebraic system. So I am not saying it is false, it is true. I am not saying it is not a truth, but it is a certain kind of a truth that really doesn't empower and enable the Dalits, doesn't really recognize their agency in terms of their challenge to the system. In fact, if you take the example of the Madhika, both the grammatical theory of caste in terms of purity and pollution and the Hindu system and the colonial construction. So both actually locate the questions of the Dalits in the past, not in the present. That is one immediate consequence that you really want to engage with the entrance in the present. That is one serious problem. And the series of kinds of paradigms of conceptualization, consensual system, interdependence, replication, substantialization, all these kind of theories really refuse to engage with the Dalit agency. And refuse to engage with the contemporary of caste, refuse to engage with the idea that the caste is kind of shaped by the state and other institutions and the reconfiguration happened in the context of state. So that is the problem with the larger commentary about caste. Thank you.